All right. Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for Quantum Today. I'm John Donohue, the Scientific Outreach Manager at the Institute for Quantum Computing. The IQC is a multidisciplinary research institute at the University of Waterloo, studying the potential and the development of quantum information science. We have researchers working on the cutting edge of physics, chemistry, mathematics, computer science, and engineering. And during Quantum Today, we'll be looking closer at some of the research happening at the quantum level. Please feel free to ask any questions throughout in the chat box. We will get to as many as possible before wrapping up. Now, before we get started with the discussion, we do have a quick pair of announcements. We have just launched the applications for the Quantum School for Young Students, or QSIS, formerly known as the Quantum Cryptography School for Young Students. QSIS is a two-week summer school for high school students interested in learning the science of quantum information. It will be held over 2 weeks in July 2022, with 1 week being held virtually and the other being in person on the University of Waterloo campus. You're able to apply to only just the virtual portion, or if you're interested applying in both the virtual and the in-campus experience. You can find more details and the application on our website. Additionally, applications are also open for the Undergraduate School on Experimental Quantum Information Processing, or USQIP. USQIP is a two-week summer school for undergraduate students taking place on the University of Waterloo campus in June 2022. USQIP is open to keen undergraduate students from around the world and packs both theoretical and experimental activities in its program. There are also summer research opportunities you can apply for at the same time, and you can find more details on the IQC website. Today, we'll be discussing quantum simulation. Now, quantum mechanics is not something that only undergraduate students struggle with. It can be a challenge to model computationally as well. By designing a quantum system to simulate another, we can potentially learn about them in a more efficient way. By using a superconducting chip to simulate a lattice of quantum particles, researchers have opened up a new domain to explore. This result has recently been published in Physical Review Letters as Quantum Simulation of a Bosonic Creutz Ladder with a Parametric Cavity, led by researchers from the Institute for Quantum Computing with collaborators from the University of the Basque Country in Spain and Purdue University in the United States. To discuss their result, today we're joined by Professor Christopher Wilson, a faculty member at the IQC and the University of Waterloo Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering, and the principal investigator of the Engineered Quantum Systems Laboratory. Chris, thank you so much for joining us today.
Oh, thank you for having me.
So just to get started, what is quantum simulation? What exactly can we learn by simulating other quantum systems?
Right. It's what I would say in many ways is quantum simulation, or especially what I'm working on, which I'd call analog quantum simulation, is a kind of waypoint in the path of quantum computation. So at some point in the future, hopefully, we'll have digital quantum computers that are error corrected and can do anything. And then we can just simulate something, we can run a quantum computer simulation, just like today we run simulations on a classical computer. but, that's still, some time away, at least like, let's say 10 or 15 years, although it's been 10 or 15 years for the last 30 years. I should be careful what I say. So what we're trying to do is we're building a circuit in this case, a quantum circuit that behaves in the same way as some other quantum system. In this case, some kind of particle field theory system. And the idea here is that we can we build this circuit that has what we would say the same equations of motion, or in the quantum case, the same Heisenberg equations of motion of the system we're interested in. And we can just let this circuit evolve naturally under the equations of motion. We kind of initiate it or initialize it in a certain way, and then we just let it evolve, and then we read out the output at the end. And in this way, we do a calculation or a simulation of a system of interest. And I'll just make the point, this has very much this is very much a precedent in classical computing. Mm-hmm. So sometimes I show some pictures, or you can find some funny pictures of analog computers from the 60s and 70s. Again, exactly before digital computers were ubiquitous and powerful, people would build analog circuits, that obeyed a certain differential equation that they were interested in solving. So that could be, a differential equation describing the stability of a jet or a rocket, or it could be a differential equation describing the dynamics of some complex chemical reaction or industrial reaction. And so you have funny things where they had programmable analog computers, which were basically bunches of op amps, which is a type of circuit with patch cords. So it looked like an old fashioned operator. So you program the computer by, plugging these things in to simulate a certain equation and tuning knobs to set time constants and things like that. These work through these were big in the 60s and 70s through the 80s. This is how we got to the moon. There were analog computers that integrated the differential equations of motion. They didn't have digital computers for these things. This is a big, and in the same way, those analog computers were eventually replaced by digital computers, and you don't really have them around anymore. And so I think this is a similar thing. So there, hopefully this is, eventually these things will be replaced. But for now, for 10 or 15 years, they could do very interesting things and do calculations that we can't do with classical computers, and they could help for a lot of things. Mm-hmm.
Okay, you're very careful there to highlight that this is an analog system. Mm-hmm. In terms of like quantum systems, what's the differentiator between an analog system and a digital system?
I mean, this could get kind of technical, but I mean, you would say when I think of like what I call like a digital quantum computer would be the kind of thing, where we think of qubits, and gates and I can write a program, based on just qubits and gates, like a classical computer with bits and gates. I can write a program, a somewhat complicated program that can kind of do any calculation, right? That's what universal means. So I could build up a calculation out of, individual bits, right, and individual gates, and things like that. But it's really kind of, I have to be doing that at that kind of bit and gate level, right? When I have this universal quantum computer, where here we're working instead, we kind of make a circuit that has the same properties of the thing that we're interested in simulating. So we might use, if we want to simulate, behavior of like a photon, or electromagnetic mode, we use an electromagnetic mode. If we want to simulate, the behavior of a spin, we might use a qubit, so a two-level system or something like that. So there's kind of a closer analogy between what we have, and we are just really studying kind of the natural, when we run the simulation, we're letting the circuit just evolve kind of naturally under the equations of motion that we've constructed. So we're not thinking about it as like bits and gates like that, although again, eventually you can do the same thing.
Oh. So we do have, of course, digital classical computers at this point, mm-hmm. and a lot of people spend a lot of time studying how to simulate quantum mechanics mm-hmm. on classical computers. How do we know, like, what makes a particular problem difficult to do with a classical computer? You mentioned in the paper some things like Lattice QCD, where we actually have tools to do it classically. What makes it difficult for certain problems?
Right. I mean, so I give a kind of, I mean, there's one just very generic answer, which is that essentially what one of the things that can potentially make a quantum computer powerful also makes quantum systems difficult to simulate on classical computers. And this is basically the fact that the phase space of the systems grow exponentially with kind of the number of particles or number of qubits that you want to do. And, so what that means, I mean, so what do I mean by phase space? Essentially, you can imagine I want to do a simulation where I'm keeping track of a bunch of atoms or a bunch of electrons or something like that, right? And so I need a certain, I need a certain number of numbers, let's say, to describe the state of the system, right? Like the position of the atom and its velocity and things like that. And that corresponds to a certain amount of memory that I would need in my computer to keep track of all this information. And the kind of the difficult thing about quantum mechanics is when I start adding, when I go from having one atom to two atoms, instead of having needing twice as much information, the information starts to grow exponentially, or it's not just additive. So the amount of memory I need to hold the simulation of a quantum system, it just gets out of hand very quickly, or becomes too big, or it can easily become too big for a classical computer. So that's kind of the generic thing that stops us if you don't do clever things. Now, people have come up with more than one Nobel Prize has been given for people coming up with clever ways, of making approximations or reducing the complexity of simulations or understanding, I don't need to really, in a practical system or some systems, I maybe don't need to keep track of all of those exponentially large numbers of numbers. So, you can bring things down, but then there are, those approximations don't work in every case, or they work for some things, but not for everything. And there are just important classes of simulations. So a lot of things, a big thing today is, people talk about quantum materials. So trying to come up with new materials with special properties, electronic properties or thermal properties, things for sensors or whatever, that, exploit quantum mechanics. And a lot of these materials, as it turns out, are difficult to simulate. So they're strongly coupled or strongly correlated materials, which are kind of buzzwords, but they're the type of simulation where I kind of need to keep track of all of the numbers. I can't make these approximations that allow me to reduce the amount of memory I need for my simulation. And so we kind of can't do calculations on a lot of these things. And it's something like you mentioned, the work eventually we want to talk about, or one far goal could be lattice quantum chromodynamics, or quantum chromodynamics, which is our theory of the strong nuclear force. So it's kind of it's what holds protons and neutrons, or quarks in together as protons and neutrons, and also holds protons and neutrons together in the nucleus. I've talked to experts in the field, something like 15% of the supercomputer time in the world is spent on calculating quantum chromodynamics, on simulations of quantum chromodynamics. So, it's a huge, it's a big problem. people throw supercomputers at it, but partly they can only calculate basic things. Mm-hmm. Like they can calculate the mass of a proton, which is actually a heroic thing to do, but they can't study really like the motions of these particles. So they can study what we call ground state properties, but they can't study dynamics of the systems. And there's also just some of the techniques that they use that are very, that have worked very well, again, fancy words like quantum Monte Carlo simulations, they just don't work on some classes of problems. Mm-hmm. There's something called the sine problem, which I think is a bit too much to explain here. But basically it means the simulation, there are just some problems where the simulation tools just don't work at all. It's not even that they, the simulations are too big, like they just fail. But these are kind of, ends up being like important problems, like, why is there, mass in the universe and, interesting things like that. So fundamental questions, so understanding the asymmetry between matter and antimatter in the universe and things like that, end up having, what they sometimes call topological features that break the simulations. And so I think, say for that community, despite having access to 15% of the world's supercomputer time, they seem to realize that quantum computers is something that they might need, to go to the next step. So, the classical computers aren't going to get powerful enough to do what they need to do.
Okay. So that's kind of the long-term goal, in a sense, is to start tackling some of those problems. Mm-hmm. In your current result, you tackle something called the Bosonic Creutz Ladder. Mm-hmm. What makes that problem in particular interesting to you?
Right. Basically, it's what we would call a toy model. what makes it interesting is it's relatively simple, and we could do it with, in the lab today as we work to build things up and kind of validate the basic ideas. But basically, it's an old model from high energy physics. And it was one, I think what's interesting about it is it's one of the earliest models. It's one of the simplest models where you can actually see these kind of topological features arise. So this is interesting for, the high energy people, but it's also one of the big topics, like topological physics is one of the big topics in condensed matter, also involved with these quantum materials and everything like that. So understanding how topology, which is kind of like a special kind of symmetry. Again, it's a bit complicated to explain, but it's basically a special kind of symmetry that some of these problems have, and it leaves you, interesting behavior, like robustness against noise and things like that. And this is just one of the simplest models where you can have distinct topological features.
Okay, so it's a simple model, but to actually simulate it, it's a little bit less simple. You use something called a parametric cavity in a superconducting system. Can you describe a bit the platform that you use to make this simulation happen?
Right. So the basic part is we have the units of our simulation are resonant modes of a microwave cavity. So a microwave cavity could be something 3D, but for us, it's something on chip. So we have essentially like a transmission line, which is something like the cable that brings, TV into your house. That's a transmission line for RF and microwaves. So I have an on-chip version of this transmission line, and then we basically cut it, on two ends, and that makes a certain length of transmission line where then, if I have a wave, so I have, in our case, microwaves, where the wavelength of the wave kind of fits just right, in that length of transmission line, we get a resonance. So we get a resonance. So those waves like to live in the mode or like to live in the transmission line or in that cavity, and other wavelengths don't. Mm-hmm. So we end up having, special a set, in this one cavity, we have a number of different resonant modes that come where I have different wavelengths that then, fit, nicely inside the length. And as it turns out, in the simplest case, even though these things are living in one cavity, they don't really talk to each other. So they end up being really independent modes. So it's like I made a bunch of different little oscillators, but in just to make things compact and simple, we've done it so that we have one device, one cavity that has all of these modes, but they really act like they're independent modes. Until we do something special, which we have, at one end of this cavity, we have a special superconducting device. It has a long fancy name called a superconducting quantum interference device. It's usually just called a SQUID, as a kind of funny acronym. But the SQUID, what we can think about it is it just in electrical language, or for what we're doing here, it's basically like a tunable inductor, which is like a tunable electrical element. And basically what it does is, we can modulate the inductance of this thing. So we just put in some other microwave magnetic field at microwave frequencies. And we modulate the inductance of this thing, but it's basically like we're kind of shaking, one end of this cavity, right? So we're kind of, we're changing its boundary condition, is the fancy word, but it's like we're stretching one end of the cavity a little bit, right? Okay. So we modulate, and that changes the resonant frequencies of these modes, because it's like we're stretching the cavity a little bit. And so it turns out if we do this at special frequencies, so I have two modes that might exist at, use numbers like 5 gigahertz and 6 gigahertz, which are kind of cell phone Wi-Fi frequencies, which is where we work. If I have a mode at 5 gigahertz and 6 gigahertz, if I shake the cavity at 1 gigahertz, which is the difference frequency of these two things, the difference between 5 and 6, it will make these modes start talking to each other.
Okay.
And kind of the quantum way of thinking about it, it would be like, I have a 5 gigahertz photon in one, and now I'm kind of shaking this thing at 1 gigahertz. And so a 5 gigahertz photon over here can kind of steal that, kind of take that 1 gigahertz of energy and kind of jump up to the 6 gigahertz mode. Or more classical version would be you get kind of sidebands. You say, I have an oscillator, I start modulating it, and I get sidebands. And if the sidebands of one mode overlap the, the other modes, then those modes start to talk to each other. And so we could do this, we can create this coupling between modes, but because we've designed it so the you know, the modes all have kind of unique difference frequencies. I can pick which modes I want to talk to each other. And so in that way, I can kind of program a certain lattice or a certain, you know, graph of connections, or say, you know, which way my photons and my resonator can move around my system. So in fact, you know, this paper that we published was on this Creutz ladder simulation, but we used the same devices to simulate a number of different models because we can just reprogram it, the device. We can reprogram the lattice just by turning on different modulation frequencies. So we make a different graph of connections, and we can simulate different geometries and models that have different properties. Mm-hmm.
So I'm wondering if we can kind of tie that model and just highlight some of the differences between that and what I think the picture a lot of people have in their head when they think of quantum computers and digital quantum simulators. Mm-hmm. The picture a lot of people have in their head is a photon, an electron, a circuit loop, whatever, that has one or no excitations in it. So mm-hmm. one electron having spin up, spin down, for example, something like that. Here we're really talking about a mode structure. Mm-hmm. Is that one photon in each part of the mode structure? Is that a collection of photons? What's occupying these modes?
It could be, for some of the stuff that we've looked at, I mean, it can be all of those things in a sense, because it depends on then what we can think about is we turn on these interactions and we create this lattice, mm-hmm. Which are these oscillators. But it depends now a little bit of how we kind of initialize it. So I can put it, the simplest thing would be I could put in what we call a coherent state, which mm-hmm. just means that I, you know, just take a signal out of my microwave generator and I kind of ring up this oscillator a little bit. And if I do that, though, essentially the dynamics will be classical. So it's just coupled modes. It's like coupled pendulums, mm-hmm. basically. But I can do things like also load it with a single photon. So mm-hmm. I could take one of those modes and I could put a single photon in it. So even though, you know, that oscillator can hold many photons, I can load a single photon. And now the dynamics really become quantum. And then, you know, I can do other things like I can load entangled states and things like that. So these same parametric excitations that we use to couple the modes, we can also do, I mean, you, John, would know what this means, like parametric down conversion. But we can, you know, the same system, we can actually generate entangled photons directly into these modes. And so now we can have entangled photons moving around in the modes and look at what happens there. So that makes things more quantum. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think we could do very similar things, and we have other projects where instead of having these harmonic modes, which can have many photons, we are using single qubits. So now we could have, you know, lattice of qubits, and now this excitation could hop around on the qubits, but now I can only have one excitation per mode. But part of this goes back to the, when we talked about the analog quantum simulation, you know, you can imagine, you know, in a field theory, you know, if I'm thinking about, you know, for the simple case of, let's say, quantum electrodynamics, which is electricity and magnetism, you know, I have, you know, at least two components. I have, you know, electrons, which are like little spins, so they could be like my qubits. But then I also have the photons, and those are harmonic modes. So those are like oscillator modes, right? So I naturally, if I want to think about simulating like quantum electrodynamics, I'm going to want to have some bits of my simulation that are like spins or qubits, but I'm going to also want to have some bits of my simulation that are oscillators, so mm-hmm. they can have many excitations, right? So, you know, some simulations, some things I want to simulate, you know, are oscillators, or we could call them bosonic, you know, and some things we want to simulate are more like fermionic, and so more like spins. So in a quantum, especially in this analog quantum simulation type of thing, it's actually useful to have, you know, to be able to mix and match kind of these different components that have that are closer, you know, to the real life thing you want to simulate. Because, for instance, you can simulate an oscillator using qubits, but it's actually really hard, right?
Yeah.
We have to make almost like a kind of digital representation of the oscillator, right, with many qubits, you know, because you have to, you know, an oscillator can have many excitations, or, you know, bosonic oscillator can have many excitations. So if I only have basic systems that can have one excitation, I have to kind of string them together in a funny way, right? So there's a lot of overhead to simulate, you know, bosonic oscillators, you know, with a two-level system or with a qubit, right? So it's good if we can kind of mix and match these elements, which the superconducting platform gives us the ability to do that very easily.
Mm-hmm. So just to kind of put a wrap on that, we actually had a relevant question from Magnus, who, when you first started describing the cavity, it did sound like addition of waves. It did sound, mm-hmm. you know, there's a very classical picture of that we can have in our heads. So is the quote unquote quantum, the hard to simulate part, really the state that comes in, or like, where is that nugget of quantum?
Yeah.
Pin a pin on it.
I think different things come. Yeah. So there, I think there can be kind of, there can be different levels. So yes, I mean, when we make this basic lattice, it's like you say, it's just kind of, it's just coupled mode theory. So I can write a quantum description, but there's also a classical description that I can write down. I can turn that quantum description into a classical description. But yeah, so if I now start to initialize it with, you know, really truly quantum states. So a single photon is a quantum state of light, you know, we could say, or, you know, entangled states could be a quantum state of light. And you get into some more complications, like to really be exponentially hard, I want to have single photons and I want there to be interactions between them, you know, and which are also things that we can engineer. But yes, yeah, so in this case, it would basically come from how quantum the simulation becomes. You know, one of the levers that, or knobs that we're using is, what is the initial state, or are we kind of adding a quantum initial state into the system?
Mm-hmm. Now, so I like that you introduced the word engineer, because there's kind of two things we think about there. Mm-hmm. That's also how we engineer the lattice, and that's how you're controlling that boundary condition. And there's also how we build things like this in the first place. So you talked about the transmission line a bit. Can you provide a few more details on like what's actually being fabricated to do these tasks?
Right. And it's not really coming out in this picture, but I mean, this is a picture of one of our parametric cavities. And what's on there is it's a snaking transmission line. So it's a transmission line that we call like meandering. So we have kind of, it's like a 5 millimeter chip, but we have a 20 centimeter transmission line on it, you know, which is then giving us all of that's this transmission line that holds our resonant modes. And what you can see are little, they're called like wire bonds. So we're just kind of bonding the ground planes on the two sides of the transmission line together, which improves the microwave mode. But basically what you see is on one side, you know, there's a 3D, a macro, kind of a bigger transmission line coming in, you know, it launches onto the chip. And then at the other end, there's this squid. And then say there's a control line coming in that puts in the flux that that parametrically modulates it and brings things together. But yeah, these are nano-fabricated chips. We make everything here in at IQC. So we have a big nanofab, or the quantum nanofab. So, you know, we start with, you know, an idea in our head, and then, you know, you go to the computer, you know, you draw in some drafting program, essentially a picture of what the, you know, you want the circuit to look like. And then you go into the clean room, and we have all of these tools for, you know, depositing. So this circuit is made of aluminum, which is a very standard metal, but it's also, you know, one of the standard and good superconductors. So a lot of the superconducting quantum computers, that's the main metal being used is aluminum. So we can, you know, put down this aluminum and pattern things, and we make the circuit that we want. And these measurements, yeah, so we didn't talk about, so we do these experiments at, say, around 10 millikelvin, so 10 thousandths of a degree above absolute zero, so very, very cold. And that's, we get to those temperatures using something, a type of cryostat called a dilution refrigerator. So those are the two pictures on the edge there. So it's kind of the can of the cryostat, or the outside view of the cryostat when it's all closed up, and then we see an inside view, actually, of, I guess, a really new cryostat before we've even put in cables. but what we can say is, you know, this is the same, if you've seen pictures in the popular press of the quantum computers at IBM or Google, you know, what you really see in those pictures is the pictures of the dilution refrigerator, you know, and then the quantum chip. So as I said, I mean, the big white thing there, the dilution refrigerator, is about, 6 feet tall. So it's about the size of a person, and then the chip, the actual processor is 5 millimeters by 5 millimeters. So it's a tiny little thing, inside this big machine that, works really hard to get down to 10 millikelvin.
Yeah, it's a big fan. No, I do always love seeing the big picture, and then you see the chip. That's just a little tiny thing in there. All right. So if we wanted to take this to the next step, so you, in your paper, you showed connectivity among four different modes. Mm-hmm. What are the limiting factors if you wanted to scale that up? Would having more modes make it more interesting? Is there something to do with the complexity of the operations? Yeah. What would you like to see as a next step?
Yeah, I think, very honestly, what kept us to four modes in that, for that paper, these first experiments, was just the number of microwave generators that we had. This is a typical thing, you do the first experiment and then you use that to ask for more money, to buy more equipment to do the next bigger experiment. That's part of it. But yeah, so I think, So part of it is just, getting more equipment and kind of scaling that up. And there's a complexity involved in all of the programming and instrument control and synchronizing everything and, figuring out how to do that on kind of large scale, which is not something that a lot of time these instruments aren't designed for that. They're not designed to have, to be built into kind of big integrated experiments. I think from the chip the device perspective, so we have, that device was already something where we designed it. For that paper, it was designed to have, a certain mode spacing, like every few gigahertz. It was designed for an earlier experiment where we wanted to have just access to a few modes. But now for this experiment, we want access to many modes. So yeah, we just make the transmission line longer, and you end up having higher mode density. You have more modes per gigahertz. So we have new devices. In fact, the picture that you saw that we showed of the device is a new device where we've gone up to this kind of 20 centimeters. In length, and it's exactly that, to get us access to more modes within the measurement bandwidth or within the frequency band where we can see things. And then just getting in there and trying to make things work.
Are there challenges with expand? Like, is it as simple as get a bigger chip, double the length, or do we have to worry about things like uniformity of the cooling? Do we have to worry about things like uniformity of the fabrication quality?
Yeah, some of that, I think there's more for us, it's things like crosstalk and things like that, so things start to affect, as I try to add more and more modes, like I try to turn on the interaction between, mode A and B, and maybe that affects a little bit mode D. Mm-hmm. And so now you would have to retune mode D and E, so you have little interactions back and forth or kinds of crosstalk. And so I think, for smaller systems, you can kind of just brute force that, and tune things up. But I think, obviously as it grows, it become in a classical, not quantum way, it just becomes, kind of exponential growth in complexity. So you need to come up with which is what we're doing now, come up with clever ways of having things auto-tune, or can we figure out a kind of algorithm so the machine calibrates itself, and things like that. And which is, on bigger scales at this point, IBM and Google or these companies are doing the same thing. Like, essentially how, from the time you turn on your computer to the time it's ready to do a calculation could be quite long, because there's a lot of tune-up that you have to do. And so reducing that is definitely a big problem. And part of that can also be circuit design. If we understand, where these interactions are coming from, in a sense, or how this crosstalk comes, we can improve things, improve the circuits to reduce crosstalk and things like that. Mm-hmm. So a lot of engineering, basically.
Fair enough. We had a question earlier from Usano that kind of ties into that a little bit. So we think about engineering, we oftentimes have a very naive picture of that in our heads, but he's wondering about what kind of mathematics are used to help solve some of these kinds of problems.
What are the new mathematics? I mean, I think from our point of view, the models we want to simulate, kind of the mathematics are there. I don't know that we're needing, well, I mean, I guess someone could come up with mathematics that could solve the problems without needing to do a big quantum simulation, you know, which is possible. But I mean, for quantum computing itself, I think the biggest, you know, I think some of the newest, the biggest places where you're seeing mathematics or development is probably in quantum error correction. So, which is not, you know, our systems are not so big on that. These analog quantum simulations aren't necessarily relying or needing to rely on quantum error correction, because we're just doing a different thing. But you know, to get to the big universal computer that we want to have in the future, and we need to be able to correct errors in a quantum system, you know, which is a very delicate thing to do, because there's the whole problem that, you know, if I look at a quantum system, I disturb it or I change its state. So in classical computers, there are error correction, but you just, you know, check, you read out the state of the memory, you look if there's any errors, and if there are, you correct them, right? Because you can, it's easier because you can just read the state of the memory and copy it and rewrite it. And you can't do these things in quantum mechanics. I can't copy information. I can't read things without disturbing it. So quantum error correction is very challenging. And I think there's a lot of, you know, innovative, there's a lot of interesting ideas and innovative mathematics or ideas connected to, you know, some of the people working on quantum error correction also work on black holes and string theory. So you're starting to see, codes for quantum error correction that have connections to like holographic theories of the universe and black holes, entropy, and things like that. So I don't know, it's kind of fun, but I think there's a lot of mathematics. The math part of it is not mine. that's not me. But I think there's a lot of stuff in quantum error correction.
Fair enough. So what other, just kind of looking ahead for yourself and your lab, what are some of the questions that you hope to answer next? What are some of the projects you have on the go or recently out that, and some of the open questions you'd like to find answers to?
I think generally with the quantum simulations, it's really just wanting to, I mean, there's a sense of basically trying to make them bigger. and, you know, because I think that's, you know, on the scale that we're doing now, they are simulatable, right? So we need to grow them so we could start to do calculations that can't be reproduced on a classical computer. And I think we kind of see the scale. I mean, it's kind of the scale of like 50 qubits, you know, the Google experiments on quantum primacy, maybe we could say now. Some people don't like supremacy. but, you know, that's kind of at this 50-qubit scale. So not for every problem, but for, you know, you start to have systems that are big enough that they're classically difficult to simulate. And I think for kind of analog simulations, it's kind of similar scales, depending on the type of problem that you're looking at. I think that's part of it, is kind of growing the complexity, adding more features, finding the right models. Because it can be subtle about what you can have models that seem very similar to each other, and one's intractable or unsolvable, you know, and one isn't, right? So I think there's a lot of work for us to do to understand, you know, what are the intractable problems and what features of those models make them intractable.
And then my last question. So these projects are always team efforts. Mm-hmm. What kind of a mix of expertise is needed to really bring a project like this together?
Right. Yeah, there's quite a broad, so you have a lot of, I have a lab, so we're experimentalists. So, but we, like I said, there's a lot of just the circuit design, and, you know, we spend a lot of time doing just microwave engineering. So using classical tools that, you know, the microwave engineers use, and then you have to do the nanofabrication, which is also a very hard thing. A lot of time and money have gone into developing these processes for making the circuits. The cryogenics is another thing, which is complicated. But then, you know, as you say, now we're trying to connect to these models with QCD. So we need to be talking to kind of, you know, the higher, more, you know, really to particle physicists, you know, who understand what these models are, because it's not something that I've learned, but also to the people who are more like computational physicists, so the people who really do these simulations like Lattice QCD or things like that. So people who, you know, have, you know, build supercomputers for doing these simulations and kind of understanding all of these things. And like I said, understanding kind of the mathematical difficulties of why, you know, something, some models are hard to solve and some models aren't hard to solve.
Oh, all right. We have a question from Dave in the chat. This is also, by the way, last chance if anyone has any questions they want to throw in there. Wondering, will we be able to simulate high temperature superconductivity with these kind of simulators?
I mean, that's certainly the hope. I mean, and this is exactly the class of model that that we're interested in. So, you know, I've talked some about this, like quantum chromodynamics or quantum electrodynamics. So these are field theories. So as it turns out, you know, in modern condensed matter or solid state physics, we also use field theories. So we would use a non-relativistic field theory instead of a relativistic one, but they're field theories. So we try to describe high temperature superconductivity as a field theory. And you know, we can't solve the models for exactly the same reasons as why we can't solve quantum chromodynamics. It's because they, we call it, they're strongly coupled, you know, so we can't use perturbation theory. And so these are exactly some of the models that are difficult to simulate. So very much so, you know, the hope would be we could, you know, maybe not saying I'm going to solve high temperature superconductivity, but you know, the idea is that, you know, we could, someone, maybe me, maybe us, would build a analog quantum simulator that could, you know, simulate high temperature superconductivity. Because say right now there are, you know, a number of different candidate theories where I can, people write down models that they think might explain high temperature superconductivity, but I can't solve them. So I can't tell if they really do or not, right?
Yeah, that's
true. So that's the problem.
Oh, fair enough. It's always more work to do.
Yeah.
All right. Chris, thank you so much for joining us today. This has been a lot of fun. Thank you to everyone who tuned in into the chat. And yeah, I just want to throw up. So I just want to throw up this final slide here. And you can find a link in the chat. If you want to read more details, you can find the paper at Physical Review Letters or by looking for the open access version on the archive link in the chat. You can also find more information about Chris's lab, both on the IQC website, as well as at the Engineered Quantum Systems Lab website seen here. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. To the audience, thank you so much for chatting with us this afternoon, Chris. And yeah, I hope everyone has a fantastic rest of the day and a wonderful rest of the day. I only have one thing to say there.
Okay. Thank you very much, John.
All right. And please subscribe to our channel to be notified when the next Quantum Today will be. And as well, if you're interested, be sure to check out the Quantum School for Young Students, eligible for high school students, and the Undergraduate School on Quantum Information Processing for undergrads. And with that, thanks again, everyone.
Okay. Thank you.